So, y'all remember when you had dreams when you were a kid? I think when we were kids, we all dreamed really easily. You know, we wanted to be a princess or a hero. I wanted to be a professional athlete myself. I'd go outside and I'd, you know, pretend to be the next Michael Jordan or Barry Sanders. I know that dates me a little bit. But, you know, last year, my son, he had his preschool graduation, and they asked him all, well, what do you want to be when you grow up? And Landon said, I want to be a police officer. And the next kid came up and he said, I want to be Landon. We looked at him and we were like, okay. Wanted to sit that kid down and see if Landon had paid him or something. But it was cute. And those things always are, aren't they? But we all had dreams when we were a kid. We all had something that we wanted to be, and some were bigger than others, but we all used our imaginations and we couldn't wait to grow up so we could get after it. And there's a great scene from the movie Up. I don't know how many of y'all have seen that movie. It's a great movie. But there's a great scene from the movie Up that does a good job showing this development of a dream from when you were kids and how life kind of changes things and how you may or may not accomplish those dreams. So I want to just give you a chance to check out that clip now.
My adventure book.
When I get big, I'm going
South America.
It's like America,
but south.
Want to know where I'm going to live?
Paradise Falls. A land lost in time.
I ripped this right out of a library book.
I'm going to move my clubhouse there and park it right next to the falls. Who knows what lives up there? And once I get there, well, I'm saving these pages for all the adventures I'm gonna have.
Only, I just don't know how I'm gonna get to Paradise Falls.
There's things that we hope for, and sometimes life gets in the way, though, and we never actually get to achieve those dreams, do we? You know, Carl and Ellie, they had a great life, but they never achieved that dream of moving to Paradise Falls. That was something that was there from the get-go, but So often we lose our ability to dream because we let the busyness of life get in the way. And you know, life happens sometimes. And yet, last week we learned that God speaks to us through our dreams and through visions. And Pastor Todd, he pointed out this verse in Acts chapter 2, verse 17. It says, "In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy, your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams." So all these things, you know, they happen in this time period called the last days. Well, we've been living in the last days ever since Jesus went back to heaven. You know, he came, he died, came back to life, and then he went back to heaven. And now we're in this time called the last days. And so all these things, prophecy, visions, dreams, these are all things that are supposed to be happening. And they're messages from God about things that haven't happened yet, things that are supposed to come. And so these are messages from God, but sometimes, so often, we wonder, well, is God really speaking to me today? I mean, if he is, it's remarkable, it's miraculous, but is he really doing this today? And so that leaves us with the question, if he is doing this, how do I know that it's God who's talking to me and not just like something I ate last night, like that burrito that I had last night, and I go and I have this crazy dream in the middle of the night, or this idea that pops into my head, and I'm just like, oh, well, is that from God, or is that just something I made up? How do we know that we're hearing from God? Well, I hope to answer that question today by looking at the Bible and what it has to say about those questions. And my name's Perry. I'm one of the pastors here at Beach Church, and I just want to welcome you all here. I'm so glad that y'all could make it here today. If it's your first time, thanks for coming and checking us out. If you've been coming here a while, thanks for continuing to come. We're glad you're here. If you're watching online, we want to send a special shout out to y'all too, especially if you're over there at J. Reuben Long Detention Center. We're glad that you all could be a part of this as well. And so today, we're going to go ahead and continue this series called Dream On. All right, we're in the second week of this series. It's a series from a church in Alabama called the Church of the Highlands. And so we got some of the ideas and some of the things from their pastor, Chris Hodges. But of course, we did our own research and did a lot of our own stuff here too. And last week, as I mentioned, was the first week of this series. And basically the takeaway was that God gives all of us dreams. He's given us all a purpose. He's called us all to something bigger than just kind of the day-to-day grind. But the difference between a God-given dream and my own dream can be difficult to know what that is. But there is a big difference between that. But again, that leaves us with that really big question. How do I know if this dream I have, if this thought I have, is something I came up with or something that God is giving me? How do I hear from God? How do I know it's him? Well, God has been doing this for a long time. This isn't something that he just started doing or stopped doing at some point. He's been doing this for a long, long time. In fact, the Bible itself is a whole compilation of God-given dreams or messages that he's given to people who then recorded it so that we could then hear directly from God by reading these words. In fact, there's a portion of the Bible that is even called books of prophecy or things to come. And these were messages and visions and dreams that God gave people. And then they recorded them so we could read it. And it was things that like, hey, you need to stop living like this or else there's going to be a consequence. God's going to bring that consequence. Or it might be something good like, hey, the Messiah is coming. Be ready. The Savior of the world is coming. Jesus is coming. Be on the lookout for him. Be encouraged. I know that the world is not the way you'd like it to be, but he is coming. And today we're going to look at one of those prophets, a guy by the name of Habakkuk. Now everybody say Habakkuk. Now try to say it three times fast. Just kidding. You can't do it. Neither can I. But you see, in Habakkuk, it's this really small book. So they call him a minor prophet because it's a small book. All right, and we're going to see if we can't learn how to hear from God through Habakkuk's experience. And let me just set the stage for you a little bit. In the first chapter, Habakkuk is in a bad place. And apparently he's been crying out for God a long time. He sees violence all around him, surrounded by violence, surrounded by evil. And he's like, God, when are you going to listen to me? When are you going to answer my call? When are you going to hear my cries? And then finally, God's like, listen, Habakkuk, I got this. Don't worry. I'm going to send this group of people called the Babylonians. All right, the Babylonians are going to come in, and they're going to deal out my punishment, my consequence, to all these bad people that you're seeing, to all this evil that's happening. And Habakkuk's not too excited about this either, because he's heard about the Babylonians. All right, the Babylonians weren't nice people. They were bad people too. He's like, what? You're gonna replace this evil for that evil? God, there has to be more to it than this. There has to be more to your plan. And so then in chapter 2, verse 1, this is what Habakkuk says to God, because he wants to hear some more. He says, I will stand at my watch and station myself on the ramparts. I will look to see what he will say to me and what answer I am to give to this complaint. So the first question I asked was, well, what are ramparts? All right, so here's a picture of some ramparts. All right, so Habakkuk withdraws and goes to the ramparts. That's the top of the wall here. All right, you have this fortress, it's in a high place, and he goes to the top. And this is not just any top of a wall. This is a top of a wall where you can actually walk back and forth. And so it's not like if it was just a, you know, straight pieces of boards or something like that. You can't walk on that. So this is a walkway at the top of the wall. So that's what he does there. So let's, Johnny, go back to that verse for me real quick. It says, I will look to see what he will say. That's something else I wanted to point out, because it's kind of a weird thing to say. We say things like that today. We say, hey, let's wait and see what he'll say. Right, we say that, but that's a figure of speech. We don't mean that literally, all right? He means it literally. He's going to go on top of the ramparts, and he's going to wait and see what God is going to say. And so I point that out because this is going to come up a couple times in this message, and I just want you to take note of this. This is kind of an important thing. So just take a note of that if you're taking notes, and just be ready to hear some more about that in a little bit. So we're going to go to verse 2 and 3 now. Then the Lord replied to Habakkuk, write down the revelation and make it plain on tablets so that a herald may run with it. For the revelation awaits an appointed time. It speaks of the end and will not prove false. Though it lingers, wait for it. It will certainly come and will not delay. And it's only three verses, but there is so much in there about learning how to hear from God. I'm telling you, it's going to be great. All right, so the first thing that you see from Habakkuk, right, he goes to the ramparts. He doesn't live on the ramparts. He doesn't go to the ramparts regularly. He's withdrawing to the ramparts. So the first thing that Habakkuk does is he withdraws. He withdraws from his normal routine. And we do this all the time in our day-to-day lives. Think about it. We go to work. We go back home. We go to work. We go back home. We go to work. We go back home. We go to school. We go back home. We go to school. We go back home. We do all these different things, and we're very, very busy all the time, aren't we? And then all of a sudden we say, you know what? It's time for a vacation. I need to vacate the area. I need to withdraw from my normal routine and get a break. We do this all the time in our normal day-to-day lives. But the thing is that our spirit needs to withdraw as well sometimes. We need to withdraw and spend time with God on a regular basis. This is something I try to do on a day-to-day basis. But I'll be honest, there are times where I'm not real good at this. And yet Jesus gives us an example that he does this frequently. Go ahead and take a look at Luke chapter 5, verse 16. He says, but Jesus often withdrew to lonely places. All right, he did this so that he could go and pray, so that he could be with his Father in heaven on a regular basis. And he had to cut out the distractions, and he had to go and withdraw to a place where it could just be him and God. And, you know, there's sometimes where I'll go through a week and I'll realize, man, you know, I spent a little bit of time with God, you know, 15 minutes here, 15 minutes there. You know, I may have skipped a couple days and then did it again in a couple days. And, you know, but I can look back and be like, man, I didn't really hardly spend any time, not real quality time with God. And so it's important for us to set aside some time in the day to actually withdraw, because otherwise you'll just blow right through the day and you'll never actually spend time with him. The next thing that we see from Habakkuk is that he waits. All right, so he withdraws to the ramparts, and then he waits to hear from God. In fact, actually, God tells him to do that in verse 2 as well. He says, you need to wait for the revelation. A revelation is coming. I'm going to show you something, but you're going to have to wait for it. And so Habakkuk goes, he withdraws, and he waits. How many of y'all like to wait for things? No, we're Americans. We don't like to wait. We want it now. That's why we got things like fast food and, you know, like TV dinners and things that happen quickly. We don't like to wait for things. We want it now. In fact, we live in a culture of busy. We value busy. When you go and you say, hey, how's it going? How's life? What do people say? They say, oh, I'm busy. Absolutely. I say it all the time. Oh, man, life's busy, man. Almost like it's this badge of honor. Because if I ain't busy, apparently I'm not working hard. And we live in a hard work culture, so you always got to be busy, apparently. Well, the problem is that busy is the enemy of prayer. It's the enemy of hearing from God, of getting alone with Him. And yet we do that. We're always so busy. And there's two verses I'd like to point out from the book of Psalms that kind of speak against this. 46:10 says, "Be still and know that I am God." The next verse here, chapter 62, verse 5, it says, "Yes, my soul finds rest in God. My hope comes from Him." God says to us, listen, you don't have to do it all. You don't have to be so busy. You don't have to go all the time. Be still. I'm God. I got this. I can handle this. Find your rest in me. That's where you're going to find your peace. But so often that's hard for us, isn't it? Well, he tells Habakkuk that he has to wait. You want to hear from me? You're going to have to wait. And so he does. But then God says in verse 3, he says, all right, you've withdrawn, you've waited, now you're going to have to write it down. All right, once you get that revelation, I want you to write it down so that way you don't forget it, so that way other people can read it. In fact, Pastor Todd mentioned this last week in the first message of this series. He said, we all have dreams. We need to write them down so we can review them and check them out and remember them and check them off when we've completed them. Praise God and say, wow, thank you, God, for giving me that dream and accomplishing it with me. You know, we have to write these things down. I'll be honest, guys, this is one of my favorite things to do. I love to dream. I really do. I love to dream about what God's going to do in my life. I love to dream about what He's going to do in my family's life. I love what He's going to do in our church's life as a leader and being in a position to make some changes and different things and what He's going to do in the community as a result. Man, I love to dream. It is so much fun for me. And man, when I can dream and I can write it down and kind of start to create a plan with it, oh man, that just really gets me going. It really does. I get excited about those kind of things. And you know, when I got here, probably about a year before that, God had kind of laid something on my heart, had given me a vision for something about being able to reach the people of my church where they were. I knew that God had created us all uniquely, that He had given us all gifts, that He had all given us a purpose. But so often it's hard to identify that, isn't it? It's hard to know. Well, is God really speaking to me in this? Or is this just kind of what I want to do? Or is He going to bless this? Or am I going to fail? And so I had this dream of trying to get people in a position where I could help them with some sort of system or group or relationship or whatever it was. And I didn't know the details, but God started to give this dream to me. And then we moved here. And then it was like, all right, well, I had to get my feet wet here and kind of get things going. And then Pastor Todd, last January, he challenged us. He said, hey, God's giving you some goals, some dreams. Write them down. He said that in January of 2018. So I wrote this thing down, and I started formulating this plan. And it was awesome because then I was able to talk to Pastor Todd about it and was able to see if some other churches were doing it and see how they did it and kind of get some other ideas out there. And then out of that was birthed the Next Steps group. Now, some of you hear about the Next Steps group, and you're like, well, what is the Next Steps group? Like, why do we keep talking about this Next Steps group? This must be for people who are new to church. No, it's not that. It's for anybody. Everybody has a next step. And that's the dream that God gave me. And He's like, hey, help people in a position where they can find their people, their place, their purpose that God has given them to help get them connected with resources in the community or in the church so that their unique abilities could be used. And this was all something that happened a long time ago, but it had to be written down so that way I could review it and keep it on my mind and kind of unpack it with Pastor Todd. That's really important. It's an important part of this. But it still doesn't answer the question, how do I know if I'm hearing from God? How do I know if it's a God-given dream or not? And I think this isn't explicitly said in this passage, but I think we can make a very direct connection. God told him to write it down so that the herald could take it to the people around them so they could read the message from him, right? Right. Well, the reason why he did that is so that other people could hear it. And honestly, I said this before, the Bible is a compilation of books that were all inspired by God. Amen. And He's given us that Bible so that we could read His word directly. Sometimes I think we stand there and we say things like, hey, well, how can I hear from God? Well, we need to read the Bible in order to hear from God. We say things like, man, God, please just help direct me in my life. How should I be living? What should I do? And I think God's standing up there up in heaven. He's looking down. He's like, really? I've already told you. It's right there. It's in the Bible. I've given it to you. I've made it really easy. We all have access to a Bible here in America. It's right there for you. All you got to do is read. My word is right there. Sometimes I think we have to stop waiting for a voice to just kind of magically appear, and we need to start looking for a verse because it's there. It's right there. And guys, that's actually why we encourage things like soap. All right, every semester we throw out these soap guides. Not necessarily to like spend a bunch of money on paper products. It's to give you a plan, all right, to say, hey, one chapter a day, get into the Word, read, have a plan. Give God a chance to speak to you. It helps break it down. We even have groups that meet, and all they do is they discuss soap. We have one on Facebook. You don't even have to go anywhere. You just go online and join the Facebook group, and you can discuss it and read it together. Why do we do that? Because it's important for us to spend time with God on a daily basis, to be hearing from Him. Because so much of what He's trying to say to us is already in the Bible. And the fact of the matter is if you get a dream or if you think you should do something and it goes against the Bible, guess what? That dream's not from God. That's your own thought. That's someone else's thought or idea. If it goes against the Bible, it's not from God. So that's one answer to that question. You know, so oftentimes people will come up to me and they'll say, hey, God told me to tell you this. It's not me, it's God. The Holy Spirit told me to tell you this. And I kind of always, I'll be honest, guys, if you ever say that to me, I'm going to listen very politely, and I'm going to thank you, because I hope it is God. But it always kind of makes me take a step back. And I start to think, is it really God? Or is this person trying to manipulate me? Because when you say God told me, you're not saying it's you. You're saying this is what God said, and you're giving yourself some authority, right? And that's, you got to be very careful with that. You got to be very careful that you're not manipulating someone to just get what you want. Because the fact of the matter is, cults were started by people who said, hey, God told me to tell you all this. This is how we're supposed to live now because God told me. He's speaking through me. So you need to be very careful with that. And I am not saying that God does not speak through people. Please hear that clearly. God still speaks through people. He does. But you need to measure what people say through reading your Bible and through prayer. Because if what they say goes against the Bible, then it's not from God. So that's one way that we know that we can hear from God, by reading His Bible. We can measure our dreams against that. And then as you read and you do that and you are able to write all these dreams down and you're able to wait and withdraw on the Lord and you do all those things, then once it's all there, you can review it. You can check it all out and you can see, well, is this still what God's calling me to? Or was that the burrito I ate last night? Is this still what He's calling me to, or is this just my own idea? Because there are some things that can be confirmed through God's word, and you're like, oh, no, this is a good thing. But it may not be the thing for you at that moment. And it's something where God might be telling you to wait, or He might be saying, hey, nope, you're not going to do this at all. There are certain dreams that I came up with in January of 2018 with the Next Steps group that are still on my list of things to maybe do someday. Because God has not opened those doors. He's not led me that direction. Or He may have even said, you know, get rid of that. That was you. That was not me. They might just be a good idea that I had, but God's got something better. So that's the practical side of this. Well, how do I hear from God? You know, we are going to withdraw. We're going to wait. We're going to write. We're going to read. We're going to review. And so if we take time to do this regularly, I think we're going to hear from God more. But that's a practical side. There's also an inspirational side of hearing from God. And I think everyone's fairly comfortable with the practical side of things, but when we start to talk about the inspirational, that's when people start to get a little uncomfortable, depending on where your background is. You know, our Baptist brothers and sisters and our Catholic brothers and sisters, they're like, this inspirational thing, this is where I start to feel a little uncomfortable. Our Pentecostal brothers and sisters, they're excited right now. They're like, inspiration, come on. But I get it. I can relate with those of you who are a little uncomfortable with it. Because again, it goes back to the people who say, well, God told me to tell you. There are people who misuse this. There are. But don't let those people stop God from speaking to us, from inspiring us and giving us dreams. Man, God, he's in the business of dreams. Another reason why this makes us uncomfortable is because it requires us to see with our hearts. To see with our hearts. We're real good and accept things easily if we see it with our eyes. We're like, well, I can see it, so I believe it. But when it's something that we're supposed to see with our hearts, we're like, I don't know. But it's actually really obvious that we do this. I mean, think about it. We all see the same news. We see the same earth. And yet sometimes we see things totally differently. Sometimes it's because of our mood or our outlook on life, right? Like the glass half full, glass half empty sort of thing. That's not really what I'm talking about. That's not really the eyes of your heart, okay? Sometimes it's instincts or intuition. That's a little bit more what I'm talking about. God's given all people instincts and intuition. You know, we all have these feelings, these gut feelings, right? But for someone who's decided to follow Jesus, it is way more than that. It's way more than instincts or intuition. He's given us the Holy Spirit to live in us, to reside in us, and to speak through us, and to guide us through our day-to-day lives. And that is the person that is supposed to be guiding the eyes of our heart. Paul, one of the great followers of Jesus, said it this way in his letter to the Ephesians. He said, "I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation, so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you." You see, Paul points it out real obviously there. He says, I hope that the eyes of your heart are being directed by the Holy Spirit. I hope that the eyes of your heart are aware of him. These are the choices that aren't necessarily spelled out in the Bible. Or it's kind of like, well, I see this in the Bible and I see this in the Bible. Which one am I supposed to do in this moment? So for example, when we had to make the decision, do we leave Michigan and come to Myrtle Beach or do we stay? What are we supposed to do? I couldn't go to the Bible and see where God was telling me to go to Myrtle Beach. It wasn't there. I looked. And I'm telling you, Jen and I, we prayed about it though. And we prayed and we prayed. And we knew that God had called us to ministry, but we didn't necessarily know where. And so we sought wise counsel. And eventually we had to trust that the eyes of our heart were being led by the Holy Spirit. And we made the decision to come down here. And I'm telling you, it was confirmed over and over and over again that this is where he wants us. And we are so glad that we made the decision to come to Myrtle Beach. And so there are times where that happens. All right? And so there's a great example here in 2 Kings. We're going to spend the rest of our time in the book of 2 Kings. This is in the Old Testament. You can look for it if you'd like, but we're going to put the scripture up here too. But let me set the scene a bit for you. All right, here's a map for you. 2 Kings. Israel was the kingdom that God had started for his people. All right? But they had gotten into a civil war, and Israel, the northern kingdom, was no longer following him. Judah, the southern kingdom, they were being led by a man by the name of King Jehoshaphat, and he was a God-fearing man. He was a good man. However, at this point in time, he was making some mistakes. All right, he was like any of the rest of us. He was human. All right, he was messing up from time to time. But the people of Israel, they were led by a new king, a guy by the name of Jehoram, or Joram for short. And this guy, he was just like his parents. He's just like his parents' parents. He was a bad dude. He didn't follow Jesus. He just did whatever the heck he wanted. Jesus wasn't alive yet. He didn't follow God, all right? He just did whatever he wanted, all right? But they are, you're right. But, and in the context of history, right? They weren't calling God Jesus at that point, okay? They were just calling him Yahweh or God or many other names. And so as a result, they weren't following him and they were just following all these other gods. And so it was a big problem for them. And it was something that God was giving them consequences, but they just weren't getting it. And one of the things that happened, go ahead and put that map back up there real quick. All right, one of the things that happened is this place called Moab rebelled against Israel. And that wasn't uncommon. You get a new king and then you're going to try to rebel against them to see if they're strong enough to actually, withhold, like, control you still. And so they rebelled, but he decided, King Joram decided, well, let's ask our relatives in the south to see if they'll help us. You know, two armies are better than one, right? Well, he wasn't following God. And so as a result, he definitely wasn't asking God if this was what he should do. But to make matters worse, neither was Jehoshaphat. So this wasn't a God-given dream. Because they never included God into this dream. They just decided to do it themselves. And Jehoshaphat agreed. He said, well, my army will be your army, and my horses will be your horses. And here's some other great advice. You know, I've been doing this a lot longer than you. Let's travel through the desert of Edom, which is right here, and let's go and pick up the king of Edom because he's in service to me. And, you know, that makes sense, right? Because three armies are better than one, right? I mean, that makes sense. The numbers make logical sense. But not surprisingly, there were some troubles along the way, and that's where we're going to pick up the story. In chapter 3, verses 9 through 10, it says, "So the king of Israel set out with the king of Judah and the king of Edom. And after a roundabout march of 7 days, the army had no more water for themselves or for their animals with them." "What?" exclaimed the king of Israel. "Has the Lord called us three kings together only to deliver us into the hands of Moab?" It's funny he'd bring God into this all of a sudden, isn't it? They never asked God what he thought, and now all of a sudden things are going bad, and they're like, "What? What are you doing, God? Didn't you lead us here? Didn't you tell us to do this, and now you're going to lead us to destruction?" No, he never included God in the first place. But this is just another example. There are God-given dreams, and then there are people-given dreams. And you need to be careful about people who say, "God said you need to do this," because it may not be from God. You got to be careful with that. And that's just another example. So let's see what happens, though. All right, he's complaining. And in the next verse, verse 11, it says this. Jehoshaphat asked him, "Is there no prophet of the Lord here? No seer of the Lord, someone who hears from God, someone who sees things from God, through whom we may inquire of the Lord?" An officer of the king of Israel answered, "Elisha, son of Shaphat, is here. He used to pour water on the hands of Elijah," which was another famous prophet. And Jehoshaphat said, "The word of the Lord is with him." So the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat and the king of Edom went down to him. And so they go and they decide to go and find Elisha. And so what you see then is that at this point, Jehoshaphat did not include God from the beginning, did he? It's caused some problems. But at least he's turning to God now, right? I mean, if we're going to get it, I mean, at least you get it eventually. I mean, better late than never in some cases. And so let's see what happens in verse 13. It says, "Elisha said to the king of Israel, 'Why do you want to involve me? Go to the prophets of your father and the prophets of your mother.'" He's like, "You don't follow me. You follow these other prophets. What are you talking to me for?" And then the king of Israel said, "No." The king of Israel answered, "Because it was the Lord who called us three kings together to deliver us into the hands of Moab." Which is not true, right? He never inquired of God. So we know that's not the case. And yet here he goes again. I won't go down that rabbit trail again, though. All right. But we can all look at this and we can say, man, it's really silly for these guys not to include God until the problems start, right? We can all say that. But if you really look at your own life, don't we all do this sometimes? Don't we all just kind of go through life and it's like, man, life is good. I got this. I can handle this. And then all of a sudden, things go south. They go poorly. And then we're like, oh, no, where's God? God, please help me. I'm in trouble now. And I think there's some times where he's saying the same thing. Like, I've been there. It's just now that you're finally asking me to be a part of it. That's backwards, everyone. That's not the way it's supposed to be. That's not how it's supposed to work. You see, if we want to stop just existing and start dreaming, we have to include God from the beginning. Okay, I'm going to say that one more time. If we want to stop just existing and start dreaming, we have to include God from the beginning. That's how it's supposed to work. We're supposed to include him from the get-go. But I get it. I mean, it's human nature to some extent that when things fall apart, when things are going well, we look to ourselves, and then when all of a sudden things fall apart, we start looking around the world for answers, right? That happens all the time. And of course, when people can't find those answers in the world, they start looking for God. But that's why it's so important for us as followers of Jesus to be in the Word daily, to be connected with God on a consistent basis, to be hearing from him. Because when those people turn to us for answers, because hopefully they know we're followers of Jesus, hopefully we're going to have some answers for them. Jehoshaphat could have been that guy, but he wasn't, because he wasn't really in relationship with God at this point. He wasn't inquiring of God from the get-go. And so instead, they had to go find someone who was. They had to go find Elisha. And so in 2 Kings chapter 3, verse 14 through 15, Elisha continues. He says, "As surely as the Lord Almighty lives, whom I serve, if I did not have respect for the presence of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, I would not pay any attention to you. But now bring me a harpist." Just kind of a weird change right there. Like, hey, I wouldn't pay any of attention to you. But since Jehoshaphat's here, bring me a harpist. And while the harpist was playing, the hand of the Lord came on Elisha. So there was a method to his madness here. But it is just kind of a weird transition. But Elisha knew what he was doing. he brought in the harpist. And so I'm going to bring in my harpist here. Justin's going to come out. He doesn't know how to play the harp, but he does know how to play the acoustic guitar. And so we don't have a harpist. We've got the acoustic guitar. And I'm just going to have him play a little bit of music for us. Because I think we can all agree that music changes the mood of a room, right? It changes things. You feel differently. I mean, if it's heavy metal or like really hard music, you're going to feel intensity, right? If it's worship music, if it's got that nice kind of rhythm to it, you can feel kind of this connection sometimes. And it's not that music and the Spirit of God are directly connected all the time. Music doesn't always bring in God's Spirit, but it can be used that way. And so you hear this music, and Elisha does the same thing, and the hand of God comes upon him. And what it does is it brings in God's presence. And the thing is that dreams are birthed in God's presence. You can just hear that, and it changes things. But if Justin stops, and then I say that, dreams are birthed in God's presence. Doesn't sound nearly as good, does it? No. Justin, when Justin's playing, there's just something about it. He's going to keep playing for me. He's going to help me preach here. He's going to make me sound a lot better in these next few minutes. In verses 17 through 18, this is what is said. Remember, the hand of the Lord is on Elisha, and he tells Elisha this: "For this is what the Lord says, you will see neither wind nor rain, yet this valley, this desert valley, will be filled with water, and you, your cattle, and your other animals will drink. This is an easy thing in the eyes of the Lord. He will also deliver Moab into your hands. You will overthrow every fortified city and every major town. You will cut down every good tree, stop up all the springs, and ruin every good field with stones." So God's like, I got this. This is easy stuff. Don't worry. Thanks for finally including me. I'll take care of it. I'll take care of this for you now that you finally sought my thoughts. But he also gives them some responsibility. That's why I highlighted those parts where it says, you will. He said, you're going to go and destroy these armies. You're going to chop up these trees and stop up the springs and flood the land. You're going to put rocks in all these fields and destroy the fields. You are going to have a part in this, because dreams go from inspiration to participation. Dreams go from inspiration to participation, because God typically requires a next step. He can do it all on his own, but for whatever reason, he's chosen to work through us. He's decided, you know what, I'm going to show off my power, but oftentimes I'm going to do it through you. You know, it's one thing to say, I'm going to be the hands and feet of Jesus. It's another thing to actually do it. So often we say, yeah, man, I'm so glad that our church is the hands and feet of Jesus. But then you really think about it. Well, how are you the hands and feet of Jesus? It's one thing to say it. It's another thing to actually go on a Beach Church Cares outreach like they did yesterday and go to the barbecue over there and go and build relationships with the people in those neighborhoods to say, hey, we love you. We don't want anything from you. We just want to get to know you. How can we help? How can we be a part of this? It's another thing to join a community group and get to know the people within your church and then say, hey, how can we collectively reach the people in our community together? It's another thing to go and get signed up for a mission trip on the app or on the website to go to Mexico in December and you can go on the 26th or the 30th, or you can go to Honduras in March. And there's all these different options that are out there. But so often we say things like, man, I'm so glad our church does these things. But are we really being the hands and feet of Jesus? Are we really participating in it? And that's exactly what God asked these guys to do. He says, hey, I'm going to get behind your dream, but you're going to have to do something too. And so that next morning, God does his thing. This water starts to rise in this desert. And it's filling this desert so much that they're able to drink and they're able to give their animals something to drink. And it's amazing. It's miraculous. It's not supposed to be happening. And the Moabites actually see it too, but it's at dawn. And there's not supposed to be water there. So the way the sun hits this water, it makes it look red. So they assume, oh, there's three armies over there. They were allied together. They must have gotten into some sort of argument or fight. And so now this valley is full of their blood. So they figure, all right, this is awesome. They killed each other off. Let's rush out of here and go and get the plunder. And so instead, they rush out of their walled city to find three very healthy, very ready armies that completely destroy them. God delivers them an easy victory. And then they do exactly what God has called them to do. They chop down all those trees. They stop up the springs. They put the rocks in the fields. They do everything that they're supposed to do. And what ends up happening is they have this God-given dream. And when you get a God-given dream, it goes from inspiration to participation to realization. Sometimes it doesn't happen right away like it did for them. I mean, it was literally the next day. Sometimes there's a lot of work where you have to put one foot in front of the other. You feel like God is calling this to you, and so there is a little bit of a grind to it sometimes. But if it is a God-given dream, those dreams will go from inspiration to participation to realization. That's how God works. Now Jarrett's going to come out, and he's going to join Justin here. He's going to sing a song for us. The reason why is I just want to give you guys a chance to just close your eyes. Bow your heads. You can stand if you want. You can raise your hands if you want. But I want to give God a chance to speak to us right here this morning. So take some time to listen to the words that Jarrett sings. And let's see if God can inspire us today. Dream again.
for my heart is mysterious, and my ways are beyond yours. So rest in my finished work. As the kingdom envelops the earth, for my heart is mysterious, and my ways are beyond yours. So rest in my finished work. As the kingdom envelops the earth, so dream again, dream again, dream.
Carl and Ellie, they had a dream. And I know it's a little bit different than what we're talking about, but they waited until they couldn't accomplish it anymore. And then Carl goes and tries to accomplish this dream, and he was able to have a great adventure and really learn a lot through the process. But don't wait for something like that to make you pursue the dreams that God has given you. As we leave here today, I want to encourage you to take some time throughout this week to withdraw and wait until you can hear from God. Take some time to be in His presence, because dreams are birthed in God's presence. Guys, it is so important for us to dream. God shows up in our dreams. That's how He speaks to us in a lot of ways. So I just encourage you to do that. And when He gives us dreams, a God-given dream, He inspires us. And then when His dreams are accomplished, His glory is seen as a result of that. And so I encourage you to take some time to write those dreams out so you can review them and so you can include God in every step along the way and pray with Him to see if this is really a God-given dream that He can give you. That He's given you so that you can take step after step to accomplishing it. I mean, how awesome would it be if we as a church were dreaming, hearing from God for our own lives and for the impact that that could have on the Grand Strand? What would it be like if we started dreaming again? Let's pray. Father, I thank You. I thank You for the relationship that You've given us, that You, God in heaven, have decided to have a relationship with us, and that You are willing to speak to us on a day-to-day basis, that You're willing to direct us through Your Holy Spirit. God, help us to spend time with You so that we can actually do that. Help us to do that by reading Your word. Help us to do that by listening to You, to withdrawing and waiting. God, help us to realize that our dreams can be inspiration, that You ask us to participate so that we can one day realize those dreams. Lord, I thank you for this. And I pray for each person that they're able to take step after step in accomplishing your dreams. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.